Good morning, students. In continuation with the previous class, we are dealing with organic irritants, animals. Previous class, organic irritant poisons in plants, plant origin. Today class deals with animal poisons. Those are all called animal irritants. Among these irritants, poisons, snakes are most important, then scorpions, wasps, bees, insects, and centipedes, millipedes, spiders, all those are organic animal poisons, irritant poisons. So first of all, we discuss with snakes. Snakes are limbless creatures with elongated bodies. The body is divided into three parts: head, trunk, and tail. And the head is oval or triangular, or sometimes it is in breadth with the trunk. And the head bears two eyes, two nostrils, and a mouth. Ears. The snakes do not possess ears because it does not contain auditory apparatus. It cannot perceive sounds, but it perceives vibrations from the ground due to presence of scales, and this perception of vibrations of ground enables the snakes to hunt prey or to keep away from dangerous predators like mongoose and humans. Humans and mongoose are the predators of the snakes. So what are the eyes? The eyes of a snake contains no eyelids, but the eyes are covered with transparent scale, and the pupils are rounded or elliptical in size. Snakes have mouth. This mouth is more expansible, which enables to swallow the prey without mastication. So this mouth contains jaws, upper jaw and lower jaw. The upper jaw contains four rows of teeth, and lower jaw contains two rows. The first two rows of teeth are along the margins of the upper jaw, and the next two rows are behind the first row, in between the in the middle of the palate. So these are called as palate tooth. Palate tooth. Venomous snakes. Venomous and non-venomous. You all know snakes are venomous or non-venomous. So venomous snakes contains two fangs. These are, in addition to the four rows and two rows of tooth present in the upper and lower jaw, these venomous snakes contains fangs, which are modified teeth. Fangs are usually two in number. These are located on one on each side of the upper jaw. They may be grooved or canalized and connected to the venomous glands, which is modified parotid salivary gland, located on each side of the jaw, just below and behind the eyes. Fangs are very, very important of venomous snakes to identify the fang marks, whether the person is bitten by venomous snake or non-venomous snake. Tongue of snake. So I told you the mouth is very extensible, and usually the teeth are present in a backward direction to enable the snake to swallow the prey. And this backward movement, backward direction of the teeth enables to swallow the prey without coming outside to escape the prey. They prevent the escaping of the prey. So mouth is very distensible. They can easily swallow the large animals or humans also. So the tongue is fork-like. In the mouth, there is tongue. This tongue is forked and can be flicked in and out very rapidly in the mouth. This is not used for, the tongue is not used for licking or sucking, but it is used to detect some scent particles from the exterior and transfer to the Jacobson's organ in the roof of the mouth. This Jacobson organ present in the roof of the mouth enables that the snake can predict the smell of the prey and smell of the predators and smell of the other dangerous persons. So nostrils, there are two nostrils, I told you. The nostrils helps to inhale the air and expel the air. So this completion of inhalation and exhalation is provided by the nostrils. The inhalation is not produced sound, but the exhalation of the air from the lungs is very loud noise. So the hissing sound produced by the snakes is due to exhalation of the air from the expulsion of the air from the lungs. This is hissing. Bosspottu antaru kada adi. So very loud noise. So Russell's viper and adders, puff adder, are the snakes which produce very loud hissing. What is the geography of the snakes? Snakes, venomous snakes found all over the world except New Zealand and most parts of the Arctic and Antarctic regions, and also Ireland, Iceland, Chile, Hawaii, parts of Mediterranean and Caribbean regions. In Britain, there is only one indigenous snake called as Viper of Berris. This is present in United Kingdom. And these snakes can molt the skin. That means shedding of the skin periodically. That means the venomous snakes molt their skin usually every 2 months. The skin cast off and turned inside out in the manner of a glove being removed from the hands. So this molding or molting enables the snake to become more alert and active. So what is the vent? I told you the body is divided into head, trunk and tail. So the trunk is very long. It varies from the species to species. The longest snake in the world is king cobra, which is 12 feet in size. So the vent is an opening situated at the posterior end of the back of the trunk, and it provides the it is used as common orifice for the elementary and the genito urinary tracts. So after the vent, there is a tail, ends in a tapering point or a stout. The tail is either padded or flat or rounded or blunt in shape. So this is the structure of the snakes. Sex of the snakes. Sexes are distinct. Each species breeds through, and hybrids are unknown. Most snakes are oviparous. That means they lay eggs. And while some of the snakes are viviparous, they some species bring forth their birth to the baby snakes. Snakes usually survive for many years, or even 20 years or more. Species, about 35,000 known species of snakes are present in the world, of which 350 species are venomous, venomous snakes. So I told you, classification of the snakes, I will tell you. So before studying species classification of the snakes depends on the presence of the scales on the body. This is called lipidosis, and its dentition and presence of scales on the body, which is called as lipidosis, dentition, osteology, myology, sensory organs, and the form of hemipenes that are present on the body, and as well as on the basis of the DNA analysis of the snakes. So the species of 35,000, among those 35,000 species, only 350 species are poisonous. Among those venomous snakes, the non-venomous snakes are only giant constrictors, belong to the family Boidae. These are non-venomous snakes, which are not dangerous. They should not bite, but they will dangerous to man. They will simply swallow the prey and animals and the human beings. Some of the examples of non-venomous snakes are, examples include rock python. You all know pythons, anaconda, like snakes which are present in the United States of America. So these pythons usually not bite, but they will simply swallow their prey. They will swallow very big, huge animals and also human beings. These are rock python, Python sibe and reticulated python, Python reticulatus of Southeast Asia, especially Indonesia, and anaconda of South America. These are all the non-venomous snakes. So classification of snakes. Snakes are classified on the basis of, I told you, arrangement of snakes, scales, dentition, osteology, myology, and sensory organs, and a form of hemipenes and immunological analysis, serum proteins, and analysis of the DNA. So on the basis of all these features, you should remember these features, and the snakes are classified into groups. So number one is Colubridae. This classification of snakes is important for your theory point of view. This family includes almost 1400 species, and 75% of the snake genera are 78% of all the snakes are present in the world. Each group is having their own characteristic features. With these characteristic features, these species can be differentiated. So short immobile fangs are present in this Colubridae group. Enlarged solid teeth are present at the posterior end of the maxilla. So these important features, short immobile fangs and solid teeth at the posterior end of the maxilla. Examples are mountain wrasse, western eastern hook-nosed snakes, and parrot snake, rat snake, wandering garter, snake eating, etc. So number second classification is Attractaspididae. Attractaspididae is the another type of group of classification of snakes. This family comprises African and Middle Eastern burrowing asps or stellate snakes, also known as burrowing or mole vipers or adders. So false vipers, that means side stabbing snakes. These snakes not bite directly head on bites, but they will side swipe and bites, which are having long front fangs. These group of snakes are having long front fangs. Those Colubridae are short fangs which are behind the maxilla. These are side swiping biting snakes. Number three is Elapidae. Under this group of classification, these snakes are relatively short fixed fun front fangs. They are up to the 10 mm size. Their length is 10 mm, and these are presented anterior to the maxilla. Examples of snakes under this group are cobras. Very important. The Elapidae group is very, very important. We are commonly encounter in our daily life these snakes. So cobras, crates, coral snakes, and mambas. These are the comes under this group. Number fourth group is Viperidae. This is also very, very important. Vipers are included in this group of classification. These snakes are having highly developed, long, curved, hinged, and canalized fangs like a hypodermic needle. This is the characteristic feature of fangs of this class of Viperidae group of snakes. There are two subfamilies. Number A is Viperinae or true vipers. These are false vipers. Attractaspididae or false vipers, and Viperidae or under this Viperidae, Viperinae group is true vipers. Those are vipers and adders. And number second subgroup is Crotalinae or pit vipers, rattle snakes, and Asian pit vipers. These are all the scientific names: Crotalus, Cystorhis. All those names you should get by heart. Number fifth group of snakes are Hydrophidae. This family comprises sea snakes. Exclusively, this group contains sea snakes, which are having short fixed fangs, as in the case of the Elapids. Approximately 330 species of snakes exist in India. I tell you that these sea snakes cannot live on the land. But in tropical country, those snakes which are living on land can swim in water. But sea snakes which cannot live on the land. This is the characteristic feature of the sea snake and land snake. Snakes which are normally found in logs, wooden logs, bricks, bricklins, or in a mud places, any other dumping yards. So this is the usual harboring place of living places of the snakes. So these snakes, which are very very common in our Indian culture and which commonly encounter snakes, are called as big four. These four snakes are called as big four, and comprises is big four comprises. Number one is common crate, Ungarus cerulis, and common cobra, common crate, common cobra, Sasquatch viper, and Russell's viper. These four snakes, which are called as big four snakes, these big four snakes are usually encountered in our daily life. So identification of venomous snakes. How will you identify the venomous snakes and non-venomous snakes? India will provide majority of snake bites in our country because of India is agricultural, more agricultural country. So many snakes are harboring at farm fields of fields, and so many people who are going to their daily work, they will be encountered with these snakes, or they will be accidentally bitten by these big four snakes. Approximately 10,000 to 15,000 deaths annually from snake bites. In developing countries where the industrialization and urbanization has developed, there are less number of deaths due to snakes. Many of these deaths due to significant envenomation. Envenomation means injection of the venom by the bite of the snake. So among in addition to these, before discussing about the differentiation between the venomous and non-venomous snakes, I want to tell you that these snakes are cold-blooded creatures. These snakes are cold-blooded creatures, snakes, and these are having a pit between the eye and the nostrils. These snakes are having pit between the eye and the nostrils. This pit enables to detect the temperature, and so that these snakes will identify the warm-blooded prey. So this pit is very very important, which is present between the eye and the nostrils. So identification of venomous snakes. So how will you identify? So non-lethal venomous or non-venomous snake bite. How will you differentiate the venomous snake bite and non-venomous snake bite? Even though it is a venomous snake bites, it may not be severe. It may not be a result of severity or death because of the some reasons. So features indicative of venomous snake. Usually dull colored snakes are usually dull color, brown, black, gray, dull green. Venomous snakes are color is brown, black, gray, green. Stout body with abruptly tapering tail and compressed tail. Broad belly scales extending across the entire width of the body. This by these features of the structure, you can differentiate the venomous from the non-venomous snakes. Small scales and triangular head, pit between eye and nostril, I told you. Presence of hood or without markings, hood, padaga. Presence of fangs and presence of rattle at the end of the tail. So common Indian venomous snakes. Indian snakes of medical importance are class 1, commonly cause death or serious disability are common cobra, common crate, Russell's viper, and Sasquatch vipers. So So these number class one. These class one venomous snakes can commonly cause death or serious disability. Those are cobra, common crate, common cobra, Russell's viper, and Sasquatch viper. Number class two uncommonly causes bites, but are recorded to cause serious effects. These are usually does not induce bites, but causes serious effects. That means local infection, necrosis, or death. King cobra and crate. Class three. These are commonly cause bites, but serious effects are very uncommon. Under class three snakes, commonly those snakes bites, but they will not cause serious effects. So snake venom. Snake venom is nothing but the toxic saliva secreted by modified parotid glands, and it is clear amber-colored fluid when fresh. It is the most complex of all poisons, containing more than 20 components. Most of the weight of the venom is constituted by its protein only. Composition of venom. Comprising a variety of enzymes, non-enzymatic polypeptide toxins, and non-toxic proteins. Composition of the venom is enzymes, non-enzymatic polypeptide toxins, and non-toxic proteins. Non-protein ingredients of venom includes carbohydrates, metals, often in the form of glycoprotein or metalloprotein or enzymes, lipids, free amino acids, nucleotides, and biogenic amines. So composition is enzymes, non-enzymatic toxins and non-toxic proteins and non-protein ingredients, carbohydrates, free amino acids and lipids. This is the composition of the venom. Action of venom. The action of venom, alpha neurotoxins. The polypeptide toxins called neurotoxins found most abundantly in elapid and hydrophid venoms. And postsynaptic alpha neurotoxins like bungarotoxin and cobrotoxin contain about 60 to 70 amino acid residues and bind to acetylcholine receptors on the motor end. Action of the venom of snakes. These venom contains, I told you, composition of the venom, and these polypeptide toxins or neurotoxins contains postsynaptic alpha neurotoxins, and these contain 60 to 70 amino acid residues and bind to acetylcholine receptors in the motor endplate. And beta neurotoxins, presynaptic. These beta neurotoxins present in the presynaptic area of the motor end plate. Those alpha neurotoxins are present at the postsynaptic junction of the motor end plate. So these beta bungarotoxin and cobrotoxin and thypoxin contain about 120 to 140 amino acid residues, and these amino acid residues prevent release of acetylcholine at the neuromuscular junction. So cobra's alpha bungarotoxin binds the acetylcholine receptors and inhibits the neural transmission at the neuromuscular junction. This is the action of the venom of snakes. Crate's venom contains beta bungarotoxin, causes an damage, initial release of acetylcholine, and damages the nerve terminal and prevents any further release of the acetylcholine. So this is the reason that crate victims often take longer time to recover than cobra victims. Russell's viper venom. Russell's viper venom contains two proteases which activate the blood clotting cascade. That means it damages the coagulating factors which are present in the metabolized in the liver. Two proteases, those are the viper. Russell's viper venom contains two proteases. Those damages the coagulating factors, alters the coagulating mechanism. Those are called RVBX, a glycoprotein activates factor 10 by a calcium dependent reaction, and also acts on the factor 9 and protein C. RVB, another protease is RVBV, an arginine ester hydrolase activates factor 5. Equus venom, Equus carinatus. Equus venom contains zinc metalloprotein ecarin, which activates prothrombin. Russell's viper can induce neurotoxic symptoms in addition to the hematological abnormalities. Causes of damage at the bite site. When a snake bite the damage at the bite site is due to hyaluronidase served to promote the spread of venom through tissues. The proteolytic enzymes hydrolyzes responsible for local changes in vascular permeability and leading to edema, blistering and bruising and necrosis. So biological elements such as histamine and 5-hydroxytryptamine contribute to local pain and permeability changes at the site of snake bite. Sea snake venom. Sea snake venom is exclusively myotoxic. Vipers are hemotoxic. Cobras, crate are neurotoxic. You remember these questions will ask you in your practical examination as viva questions. So cobra, crate are neurotoxins. Vipers, viperidae group and process hemotoxic and also neurotoxic, but predominantly hemotoxic. And sea snakes contain myotoxic. Predominantly these are myotoxic. The venom is myotoxic and contains hyaluronidase, acetylcholinesterase, leucine, aminopeptidase, and 5-nucleotidase, phosphoaminoesterase, phosphodiesterase, and phospholipase A. Sea snake venoms are highly toxic, and minimum lethal dose of venom as 0.05 mg per kg is enough as a lethal dose. Very minimum quantity is enough to endanger the life of the person. It is estimated that the minimum lethal dose for a 70 kg man would be the 3.5 mg or about 1/3 of the venom injected by a fresh adult sea snake. Snake bite. What is the epidemiology of the snake bite? That means United States of America records only 6,000 to 8,000 venomous bites per year, with mortality ranging from only 5 to 15 deaths. India records about 2 lakhs bites, of which nearly 15,000 end in death. In Britain, oddly 2,200 bites are reported each year and only 14 deaths have occurred in the last 100 years. You can imagine the difference between the developed countries and agriculture countries. India, among the various states in India, Maharashtra records high incidence of snake bites, more than 1,000 bites. Other states with significant reportage of snake bites include West Bengal, Uttar Pradesh, Andhra Pradesh, Tamil Nadu, and Kerala. Most of these bites are said to be due to sea-scaled viper. Almost 2/3 are due to viperidae bites. That means viperine bites. In this, at this juncture, I will remind you that the difference between the cobra bite and viperine bite, colubrid bite and viperine bites, a table is given in your Narayan Reddy textbook. And our Narayan Reddy textbook, you can go through it as it is important. And also difference between cobra and viper, and difference between colubrid and viperine bites, and poisonous venomous snakes and non-venomous snakes. There are 3 tables given in your given in our textbook. You can go through it. I am telling as a whole, but you can go through as a easy ready recorder as given in your in our textbook as a like a table. So sea-scaled viper almost 2/3, 1/4 of the number is due to Russell's viper, cobra, crate, pit viper, etc. So what are the clinical features of the venomous snake bites? Non-venomous snake bite. There is a difference between non-venomous snake bite, that means non-poisonous snakes bite, and poisonous snake bite. Psychological shock as a result of the fear and apprehension associated with the snakes. So whenever a person is bitten by a snake, his fear and apprehension leads to his neurogenic shock and may lead to death. So in your treatment, you have to assure the patient that the verbal assurance is very, very important, that will not be it will not endanger in your life. Like that, your doctor's verbal assurance is very, very important to reduce the fear. Every bite, either venomous or non-venomous, leads to some degree of shock characterized by giddiness, syncope, sweating, palpitation, tachycardia, and hypotension, which leads to death. So venomous snake bite, poisonous snake bite, snake bite of a poisonous snake. So number one is without envenomation. Even though the snake bites, poisonous snake bite, venomous snake bite, but it will not inject the venom completely or a little amount. What are the reasons? Number one is, without envenomation, the snake bite of poisonous snake without envenomation, that means without injection of the sufficient quantity of the venom. Number one, when a highly venomous snake bites a human, serious envenomation may not occur. That means much quantity of the venom will not be injected into the body. Why? Because that 20 to 50% of venomous bites are not attended with serious toxicity, because dry bite, number one, is causes dry bite. A snake does not always inject venom at the time of biting. Protective gear. If whenever a snake bites a person, the envenomation may not occur in the case of bites inflicted on feet covered with heavily clothed parts or heavily having stockings or leather stockings like that. But if the person wears shoe with stockings, leather stockings, then if the snake bites, the venom will not be injected. This is protective gear by the person. Leakage of the venom, that means when a snake bites a person, some major quantity of the venom may leaks and drop and fall on the ground. It will not enter into the tissues. So head on bites, that straight bite will inject more quantity of venom into the bite side, but side swiping of the biting snakes will not inject sufficient quantity of venom. So superficial bite, whenever a snake bites, the bite may not be deep and it will be a superficial bite. In this case also, the sufficient quantity of poison may not enter the body. These are the causes of not sufficient quantity entered into the bite site, and it will not cause a serious effect even though the bite is venomous snake. Bite is due to venomous snake. So with envenomation, that means poisonous snake with full of venom injected into the tissues. Number one, colubrid bite. These are differentiated, varies with the classification of the different classification of the snakes. So with venomous poisonous snakes, bites with full sufficient quantity injected into the tissues are differ with their group of snakes. Number one, colubrid group of snakes, when bites, the clinical effects of colubrid snake bites are generally localized and comprises pain, edema, erythema, ecchymosis and numbness, which resolve over 1 to 2 weeks. Excessive salivation with metallic taste and headache have also been reported by the bites of the colubrid group of snakes. So in the elapid group of snakes, when bites, the local effects are minimal local manifestations like pain and swelling, and the lesion emit a putrid smell and break down with the loss of skin and subcutaneous tissues. Systemic effects, those are local effects, and systemic effects due to elapid snake bite or neurotoxicity is the dominant clinical feature of elapid bites. Symptoms usually occur within minutes to half an hour in cobra bite, while crate bite will be delayed to several hours. I told you what is the cause of the delay. The venom of action of crate is damages the nerve endings. So the acetylcholinesterase, the venom of the crate damages the nerve endings and the symptoms are delayed. So pre-paralytic stage, these are all the systemic effects of elapid snake bites. Pre-paralytic stage is symptoms of clinical features are vomiting, ptosis and blurred vision, external ophthalmoplegia, paresthesia and hyperacusis, headache, myalgia, vertigo, hypersalivation due to autonomic stimulation. And paralytic clinical features in paralytic stage, the facial muscles, palate, jaw, stung, vocal cords, neck muscles, and muscles of deglutition are become progressively, flaccidly paralyzed. Respiratory arrest occurs. Loss of consciousness and convulsions may appear. Blisters and skin discoloration may develop, and renal complications are somewhat rarely seen. Elapid bites, disseminated vascular intravascular coagulation often seen by these snakes. So, what are the symptoms produced by the viperoid bites? Local effects are the viperoid group are pit vipers and pitless vipers. The pitless vipers as well as pit vipers. Marked local manifestations develops within half an hour. Intracompartmental pressure syndromes will develop. Compartmental syndrome is the one of the characteristic feature of viperoid bite. Swelling first appears at the around the bite site and spreads quickly to involve the whole limb and adjacent trunk. Systemic effects are hemostatic abnormalities are very, very characteristic features of viperoid bites. That means coagulative disturbances will arise in viperoid bites. The first evidence of this is present is bleeding from the bite site. Hematuria is seen within few hours of the bite, and lateral gingival bleeding will develop, and epistaxis, hemoptysis, hematemesis, ecchymosis, intracranial and subconjunctival hemorrhages will be developed. All those are coagulopathies due to I told you the action of the venom of the vipers. So viperoid environment is almost synonymous with incoagulable blood picture. Hypotension is an important manifestation in all viper bites. Sasquatch viper bites has hemorrhagic manifestations more due to primary pathological fibrinolysis. This is the Sasquatch viper bites. The hemolysis or hemorrhagic manifestations are due to the primary pathological fibrinolysis than disseminated intravascular coagulation. Common ECG changes of these viperoid bites in snake venom malmation are common among all those groups are sinus bradycardia, sinus tachycardia, sinus arrhythmia, and tall T waves. ST depression with flatter inverted T in all chest leads, ST depression with the T inversion inferior leads and or anterior leads, ST elevation in leads V1 to V6 and AVL, Q wave V1 to V4 and the ST depression in 2, 3 and AVF. First degree and second degree heart block can also seen. Hydrophid bite. What are the clinical features of hydrophid bite? So local effects are sea snake bites are well known to produce minimal local effects. The bite itself is painless and the victim not even realize that he has been bitten. So that much local effect is very, very minimal. The sea snake bite is painless. Even the person will not recognize that he was bitten by the snake. What are the systemic effects? The dominant clinical feature is myalgia with stiffness and tenderness of muscles because the sea snake venom is predominantly myotoxic. This is due to the myotoxic of the sea snake venom. The mechanism is due to rhabdomyolysis. Because hydrophid venom is predominantly myotoxic. I told you the sea snake venom is predominantly myotoxic. Myoglobinemia, myoglobinuria will occur resulting in acute renal tubular necrosis and renal failure. Trismus is an ugly feature. Passive stretching of muscles is painful. Later flaccid paralysis will develop beginning with the ptosis as in elapid bite. Ptosis will be seen in elapid snake bite. This ptosis also can be seen in sea snake bites. Hyperkalemia present due to the release of potassium from damaged muscles. Neurotoxicity includes ptosis, ophthalmoplegia, dysarthria, blood red, double vision, mitriasis also can be seen in hydrophid bites. So how to diagnose the snake bite? First, you have to see the fang marks. Classically, there should be two puncture wounds which are separated from each other by a distance varying from 8 mm to 4 cm depending on the species involved. A side swipe produces only a single puncture. I told you some snakes will bite, not head-on bite, but they will bite side swipe. That means they immediately when a danger is, they expect, immediately they swipe by side and they will bite. Multiple bites could result in numerous fang marks. Many non-venomous species like wolf snake have large front teeth and which inflicts bites that look similar to fang marks. Occasionally, fang marks may not be clearly evidence or may not be clearly visible. So number two is how to diagnose a snake bite. Number one is fang marks. Number two is identification of snake. That means some of the persons will bring the snake, dead snake. Whenever a snake is bites a person, the neighbors or the relatives will bring the along with the patient. They will bring the dead snake. They will beaten the snake and they will brought to the hospital. Sir, this is the snake bites the person. So you can identify the snake because of to identify the snake only. I told all the features of this snakes or non-venomous venomous snakes. How they the morphology of the non-venomous snakes and venomous snakes. So identification of the snake is important to give the treatment. If you identify this this bite is non-poisonous, then the treatment is very very easy and you can manage the patient. If it is a poisonous bite, then as a doctor you will be very alert and you should treat the patient very cautiously. Laboratory investigation should be done. Number one is hematological anemia should be rule out. Leukocytosis, thrombocytopenia, high hematocrit initially and later it falls. These are the laboratory evidences. Evidence of hemolysis, fragmented RBC like cystocytes and helmet cells will be seen. Prolonged clotting time and prothrombin time, prolonged partial thromboblastin time and depressed fibrinogen levels and elevated FDP fibrin degradation products and D-dimers will be elevated. And also D-dimer, you all know nowadays in this period, lockdown period or in corona period, all those persons who are positive, they are also every laboratory will doing this D-dimer. This will give the coagulation variations will seen will be diagnosed by the D-dimer. Number two is ECG changes. Common ECG changes will be, I told you, all bradycardias, ST segment elevation, TE wave inversion, QT prolongation and changes due to hyperkalemia. All these ECG changes will be studied. Metabolic changes are hyperkalemia, hypoxemia and metabolic acidosis or lactic acidosis due to increased anion gap acidosis. And urine, hematuria, proteinuria, hemoglobinuria, myoglobinuria also seen. Renal, acute renal failure, all features of ectopia will be present. Chest X-ray produce can be taken. The chest X-ray shows pulmonary edema changes and intrapulmonary hemorrhages and pleural effusion. So X-ray of bitten part. So bite spot X-ray will shows tooth or frag particles on the bite site. Embedded snake's tooth or fang fragments. Immunodiagnostics. Immunological detection of venom antigens in body fluids can be accomplished by ELISA test. So how to treat the venomous snake bite? So first aid measures. I told you, you should give the verbal reassurance. That means every person, whenever bitten by a snake, whether it is non-poisonous or poisonous, venomous or non-venomous snake, first he will fear. The fear leads to neurogenic shock and it leads to death of the person. So verbal reassurance is very very important. Immobilization is very important. Immobilization by grip bandage of the part where the bite, above the bite spot, the grip bandage is very very important. So for that, the immobilization of the part is very important and the person will not move rapidly or vigorously. The vigorous movement or the quick movement of the person or rapid movements of the person may increase the flow of the venom very rapidly through the circulation. So the surface lymphatics will very rapidly transfer the venom to the circulation. So immobilization is very very important. And also beverages, that means coffee, drinks and alcohol should be avoided because these beverages will not will enhances the absorption of the venom. And tourniquet, it is very very important. First aid measures, these are all the first aid measures. Tourniquet is very very important. Above the level of the bite, there should be a tourniquet. This is coming in good olden days. Everybody will tie the bitten spot above the bite area. The tourniquet will be applied, and as a belief, this tourniquet will occlude the spreading of the venom to the circulation, and it reduces the flow and decreases the flow of the venom into the circulation. But if you tie the tourniquet very tightly, then there will be a ischemia and necrosis will develop, and the tissue damage will occur, and he may lose the limb. So tourniquet is not advisable, but the tourniquet, whenever you tie the tourniquet, it should not tie very tightly, but immobilization is very important. It is immobilization of the person is more important than tourniquet. Incision and suction, that means in good olden days or nowadays, some practitioners will apply the incision at the bite site and suction the suck the poisonous from the bite site is a first aid measure. It nowadays also some practitioners will use this with suction apparatus, but it will cause some disadvantage. That means it may absorb or it may suck in addition to the poison venom, it also sucks the body fluids, and it may leads to damage to the tissues, and tissues may lead necrosis. The incision and suction only suck the venom only 10 to 15% of venom, but the damage is more. Cryotherapy can be given. Cryotherapy means, that means application of the chilled ice piece. This will occlude the transportation of the venom into the circulation. So cryotherapy also first aid measure, and electric shock in olden days, the electric shock at the bite site may be given in olden days. And drugs, treatment with drugs is very very important. So how not to treat a snake bite? The following measures are potentially harmful and must not be undertaken. So how not to treat a snake bite? Snake bite person should not be treated like this. Application of tight tourniquet will be avoided, and cauterization at the bite site should be avoided. Multiple deep incision through bite site should be avoided to relieve the compartmental syndrome. Some persons will give multiple incisions to the bite site to relieve the compartmental syndrome, but these multiple incisions may damage the person and may lead to gangrene and septicemia and leads to death of the person. Suction by mouth or vacuum pump or syringe is also avoided. Application of injuries, suction by mouth is very very dangerous. If you are having any injuries, mucosal erosions or any injuries at the mouth, this venom will absorb into the erosions of the from the mouth, and it will be dangerous to the suction, a person who is sucking the venom, try to suck the venom. Application of injurious substances such as potassium permanganate, phenol also should be avoided. Application of electric shock also avoided. Cryotherapy also avoided. Use of herbal, folk, ayurvedic medicines or should be avoided. So what are the treatment in hospitals? Immediately you should admit the patient, and you have to keep observation, intense observation of the patient for 24 hours. Check and monitor the vitals and pulse rate, respiratory, blood pressure, blood urea, creatinine, urine output and urine analysis. Also provide some important clues like hemoglobinuria and myoglobinuria, whether it is a snake bite, sea snake bite. Urine analysis is important to rule out whether it is a snake bite or land snake bite. Vomiting, diarrhea, abnormal fluids, prothrombin time, activated partial thromboplastin time, and ECG, D-dimer, FDB, ABG, blood arterial blood gas analysis to rule out the whether it is metabolic acidosis, to correct the acidosis, you should do the arterial blood gas analysis. So next is, you can give the to pain relievers. You cannot non-steroidal NSAIDs, but you can give the pain relief like paracetamol, and then in some cases before going to the anti venom therapy, you also give the anti tetanus toxin, because Clostridium tetani may present on the mouth of the snake, so it may enters through the bite. So if the person has not taken the TT injection, you can give the tetanus toxin vaccine, and then go to the anti venom therapy. Before going to the anti venom therapy, you should not give the so many practitioners will apply the test dose of anti snake venom, but it is not useful to give test dose, because the anti venom is the drug of choice to treat the patient. So you should give the anti venom. So by giving test dose and delaying the treatment, you should avoid the test dose, and you can directly give the prophylaxis for anaphylaxis reaction, and directly treat the patient with anti venom, anti snake venom. So anti venom therapy, Reed's criteria modified by person for anti venom therapy are as follows: prolonged or recurring hypotension can you can start the anti venom treatment, and persistent recurring shock instead of persistent recurring shock, you can start anti venom, and pronounced leukocytosis, you can start. Protracted gastrointestinal symptoms like in hemotoxic poisons, you can start the anti venom therapy. Acidosis, ECG changes, raised serum creatinine phosphokinase, that means cardiac enzymes, if rises, you can directly start the anti venom therapy. And swelling at the bite site, hemolysis, pregnant women and small children, you can directly start the anti snake venom therapy. So this is the treatment of snake bites. Then scorpions, order scorpion. What is the time? So order scorpionidae. Scorpions. The members of this order comprise scorpions, capable of inflicting severe and sometimes fatal stings. There are at least 650 different types of scorpions divided into 6 families. Most species are nocturnal and seek areas that are cool and moist. That means snakes are dwell at cool areas and moist areas. The anatomy of the scorpion. Scorpion has a cephalothorax, fused head and chest in abdomen, and a 6 segmented tail, which terminates in a bulbous enlargement called telson. The telson contains the stinger and venom apparatus. In addition, the scorpion also has 2 claws which help to grasp its prey. Scorpions differ in color from straw yellow or light brown to black. Scorpions are found in different colors, yellow color, light brown color, and black color scorpions also present. Indian species are Mesobothus tamulus, red scorpion. It grows up to 3 inches in length. Larger scorpions are also found in the outdoors. Pavonia species, which grow up to 7 inches. As a general rule, scorpions with thick and powerful claws, which are less toxic, while those with slender claws are more toxic. Scorpions sting, they do not bite. Scorpions sting, scorpions will not bite like snakes. Venom of scorpion. The main toxins include phospholipases, acetylcholinesterases, hydroxyanidase, fluorotaxin, and neurotoxins. The venom of Bothus species of Indian contains phospholipase A, which causes gastrointestinal and pulmonary hemorrhages and disseminated intravascular coagulation. What is the mode of action of venom of scorpion? The most scorpion venom affects sodium channels and with prolongation of action potentials, and also depolarization of the nerves. parasympathetic nervous systems. So both adrenergic and cholinergic symptoms will occur. Hyperkalemia, hyperglycemia as a result of insulin, reduction of insulin secretion and increased secretion of renin and aldosterone are characteristic of sting by Mesopotus tamulus. Clinical features: local, rapidly developing excruciating local pain, swelling, redness and regional lymphadenopathy. Systemic symptoms are signs of autonomic stimulation occurs, comprising midriasis, profuse sweating, urticaria, excessive salivation, vomiting, parasternal lift and priapism. Hypertension, bradycardia, tachyarrhythmias and ventricular premature contractions will develop. Pulmonary edema also seen in the sting of the scorpion. Intracerebral hemorrhages also results, convulsions may occur. ECG changes involves peak T waves in leads V2 and V6. Treatment during transport to hospital is very, very important and immunologist is important. During bite site and transport to the hospital, you should immobilize the patient and local application of the ice packs and negative pressure suction is important. And after arriving the hospital, treat for circulatory failure, respiratory failure and allergic manifestations and correct fluid and fluid disturbances and acid-base imbalance. Circulatory failure can be treated by giving the IV fluids. If not resuscitated, you can give the inotropic support by dopamine and noradrenaline drips, and respiratory failure will be supported by assisted ventilation, or you can intubate the patient and connect it to the ventilator or back and mask ventilation, or if it is minor respiratory failure, then you can put on mask ventilation, and if it is severe respiratory distress, then you can put on the patient on ventilator. Allergic manifestations can be treated by antihistamines and other drugs, and fluid imbalance and the acid base imbalance should be corrected. That means metabolic acidosis will be treated. Rosuvastatin hydrochloride, it is the important drug and the drug of choice which acts as an antagonist to scorpion venom. Rosuvastatin and is also cardioprotective. Hypertension is conventionally managed with nifedipine and hypertension is treated with dopamine. Pulmonary edema will be treated with rosuvastatin or furosemide. And agitation and convulsions should be controlled by IV diazepam or fosphenytoin. Persistent vomiting should be given by metoclopramide. Anti-venom therapy. Scorpion anti-venom effective against Mesopotus tamulus has recently been introduced. The recommended dose is 1 vial reconstituted in 10 ml of injection of water initially, followed by further doses required. So venomous insects and other centipedes, millipedes, we will discuss in another topic. When I continue to tell another topic, I will briefly tell this about these venomous insects and centipedes, bees and wasps. So these are the snakes, the big four snakes. See, cobra. This is the hood and those are the binocular spectacle mark. Two eyes, nostrils. This is the spectacle, binocellate mark, spectacle mark. Monocellate cobra, only monocellate spectacular mark. This is black cobra. These are the scales. The cobra is having a distinct feature that the third supralabial touches the nose and the eyes. Third supralabial touches the nose and the eye. This is the most distinguishing feature of the cobra. So morphology. Common cobra is usually brown or black in color. Distinctive snake growing up to 5 to 6 feet in length. It is distensible neck that can be expanded into a hood. At the dorsal side of the hood, there may be a monocellate or binocellate spectacle mark. Features: Bengal cobra, Naja, Kautia, and Andaman cobra, Naja, Sagittifera. Third supralabial shield touches the eye and the nose. Also, a small wedge-shaped scale is present between the 4th and 5th infralabials. These are the characteristic features of the Naja cobra. Another important feature is said to be the presence of three small scales just behind the each eye. Common crate, scientific name is Pungarus cerealis. Other common names, Indian crate. Geographical distribution all over India. And morphology, steel blue snake growing up to 3 to 4 feet in length and sometimes 7 feet, with whitish brands or half rings throughout its back, a chain of hexagonal large scales throughout the mid dorsal aspect of the body, a subcaudal ventral scales distal to the vent or undivided, unlike other elapids. These are the crates are having ventral scales which are undivided. Fourth infralabial scale is the largest of the infralabials. This is the characteristic feature of the crate. Common, this is the crate. These are the whitish ring throughout the body, hexagonal scales on the dorsal aspect. These are the hexagonal scale on the dorsal aspect. So, saw-scaled viper, scientific name is Equus carinatus. Other common names are carpet viper, Forsa, geographical distribution all over India, especially plains and deserts. Physical appearance, small snake about 1.5 to 2 feet long and is usually brown in color. The head is triangular with small scales. A characteristic whitish arrow shaped crow's footmark is present on the head. The pupils are vertical, scales are serrated. When agitated, it throws itself into a double coil like a figure of eight. When agitated, the viper will coils, double coils like a figure of eight. This is the saw-scaled viper. The head is very triangular in shape. Russell's viper. Scientific name is Vipera russelli, Dubois russelli. Geographic distribution all over India. Physical appearance, brownish, stout snake growing up to several feet in length. The head is triangular with a V-shaped mark and the apex is pointing forward and is covered with small scales. Pupils are vertical. Fangs are long, canalized and hinged, being erected at the time of striking. There are three rows of chained dark spots over the entire body. Russell's viper is known to hiss loudly when agitated. Like other vipers, it is viviparous. Vipers are viviparous. This is the Russell's viper. These are the scales. These are the fangs of the viper. Canalized, hinge-shaped fangs. King cobra. The scientific name is Ophiophagus hanna, Naja bungarus. Other common names are Hamadryte. Physical appearance, the cobra is the largest venomous snake in the world and grows up to 8 to 12 feet more in length. Like the common cobra, it has a hood, but the hood is lack of monocellate or binocellate marking. This king cobra has no marking on the hood. It is the largest snake of the world, 12 feet and above. Banded crate, scientific name is Bungarus fasciatus. Geographical distribution, eastern parts of India. Physical appearance, the most distinct feature of the snake is the presence of glistening broad bands of yellow alternating with black. This banded crate is having glistening broad bands of yellow color alternating with black color. These alternating bands encircling the body and are almost equal in width. The banded crate has a marked vertebral ridge that gives it a permanently emaciated look. Nature of venom is predominantly neurotoxic. This is the banded crate. You can see the alternate black and silver bands. Pit vipers. The vipers are characterized by the presence of pit between the eye and the nostril, I told you. Pit vipers with the small head scales, common green pit viper. Pit vipers with seeds on the head. Hump-nosed pit viper also present. This is green pit viper. This is Malabar viper. This is hump-nosed pit viper. This is the hump-nosed pit viper. Coral snakes. Coral snakes are generally small, 2 to 3 feet, brightly colored snakes which are not venomous as the other elapids and vipers. Common Indian coral snake or Gunther's coral snake. Scientific name is Hemibungarus nigriscens. These coral snakes are poisonous snakes, but not as much as elapids and vipers. This is coral snake, Hemibungarus nigriscens. Sea snakes. These are approximately 47 species of sea snakes. Grow up to 4 to 5 feet in length, occasionally 9 feet. The venom of snake is a sea snake, I told you. The species are Anhydrina cystosa, beak sea snake. The scientific name is Anhydrina cystosa. And Hydrophis, another species is Hydrophis vituberculatus. It is seen in the Bay of Bengal and coast of Sri Lanka. Hydrophis cirrillescens is seen in the Arabian and Bay of Bengal. Hydrophis cyanocinitus is encountered in the Persian Gulf. It is seen in Persian Gulf. Hydrophis speciatus is seen in the Bay of Bengal. Beaked sea snake. This is the beaked sea snake. Hydrophis Anhydrina cystosa is the beaked sea snake. Cobra bite. Minimal local effect. This is the fang mark, bite mark. You can see the local erythema and swelling. This is the viper bite, cobra bite. This is the swelling and the erythema, blister formation and wound formation, necrosis formation. So cobra bite, ptosis. I told you CNS complication. One of these is the ophthalmoplegia and ptosis. Ptosis, drooping of the eyelids. This person has developed the neurotoxic symptoms, CNS symptoms, and developed ptosis. This is the viper bite. This is localized swelling of the lower limb. Viper bite hematuria, gingival bleeding, coagulation defects, and causes gingival bleeding and hematemesis. Viper bite produces the hemotoxic poison, produces the hematemesis, and also spot ptosis in Russell's viper bite also viper. Russell's viper also, in addition, it is a hemotoxic, predominantly hemotoxic, and in addition to the hemotoxic, it produces neurotoxic symptoms also. That's why I am showing this slide. This viper, Russell's viper bite, also develops ptosis, neurological manifestation. So classical fang marks, those are the two bite marks which are classical fang marks. This is the single fang mark, indistinct. This is not invisible, it is not clearly visible. This is the complication of the tight tourniquet. So occluding the blood circulation and developing the necrosis and erythema and swelling, and finally the death of the tissue, necrosis. These are the multiple incisions which are unnecessarily given to relieve the compartmental syndrome. Through it, the sepsis will develop and the person will develop septicemia and leads death. So honeybee, paper wasp, hornet, yellow jacket, fire ant bites. This is red scorpion, Mesobotha, Tamilus, I told you. And black scorpion, scorpion sting, sweating, midriasis. These are the clinical symptoms of the scorpion bite. And this is the excessive salivation due to scorpion sting bite. And this is the priapism due to scorpion sting bite. Unnecessary tourniquet of scorpion bite producing the necrosis of the death of the tissue. This is the millipede, centipede. So with this, I finished with this organic irritants. I will tell you in brief the wasps and bees in next, when I deals with the next chapter. Okay, thank you for patiently hearing this subject. I think it is interesting. Okay, na? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay, thank you, children.